Have not discovered your beauty inside you. Okay? Don't let what others say define you. So this is also a time, in order to support one another, we will have to be vulnerable. That means we're willing to share what is our weakest point and willing to be comfortable that it's okay if how people look at us. if you are anxious very, very often, many, many times, you will always have, the chemical will change such that you got stuck with anxious thought or anxiety. All right. So that's why it's very important that your emotions, if it's positive, you will stay positive.
So I think, like many of us, we're very hard on ourselves, lah. So everyone like can see that you're beautiful, but to you, you view yourself at another way because you're too hard on yourself. And this really speaks, lah, because 60-70% is negativity, ma. So I just want to really tell the person, don't be too hard on yourself as well. So yeah, people see the different you.
We are not here to judge one another. We are here to support one another. And we are not here to look at the other person and say, hey, why this person like that? No. Because this is about building one another up. You're beautiful, yes.
You're you. There's only one you in this world.
Yeah, unique. You're unique.
I think like in certain point of our life, we do feel a certain way like about ourselves that is a negative, like instant, like ugly and things like that. I just want to tell whoever the person is, right? You are beautiful. Yeah, you're beautiful just the way you are. Yes, that's right. You're beautiful just the way you are. And every one of us is created in a unique way. On top of the outer beauty, also there's inner beauty as well. I believe that whoever the person is, your personality will shine. Yeah, as you progress in life. So I just want to encourage you that you are beautiful inside out.
Take it back, tear it, throw away and tell yourself no more these negative thoughts that you have. Yeah, and throw it and dump it away. Okay, that's the end of my negative thoughts about myself.
Welcome to BBTC. Let's give our fellow brothers and sisters a hand to welcome each other in the house of God. Hallelujah. Let's turn to the left and right, back and front, and say that you are beautiful or you are handsome. Okay, come. Ladies, say you are beautiful. Guys, say that you are handsome. Amazing, amazing. Awesome. You see, we are so blessed as a family of God. We speak positive words to one another. We encourage one another in the house of God. There is four announcements before the worship segment. The first announcement, if you notice, today the screen like shot off two. Where's the left and the right? Only left center. Just to share with you that currently BBTC Sanctuary is going through some renovation. So do bear with us for the next 2 weeks, even as we bring about upgrade for this sanctuary. So stay, wait, and enjoy the coming screen that we're going to have. Second announcement is restoring the foundation. I just want to share a testimony that was given. It's about this participant who are very blessed in this healing ministry, RTF, where he signed up. He was hoping to receive healing for his diabetes. But through that sessions, he realized that he has been blaming God. And because of that, he felt very unclean. He felt very unworthy. He felt that he cannot serve God. No, God will not hear him. But through the ministry, all the lies, all the ungodly beliefs, all the fear, all the things that does not belong to God has removed. He starts to begin to put on the word of God, that God hears him, God heals him, God can use him. And today, he say that because of this RTF session, he felt more healed. And he said, God, use me to serve him for his kingdom. Can we give God praise? Hallelujah. This is healing. Healing is not only the physical. Healing can be the emotional, spiritual, and every aspect. So we do encourage you, BBTician, please get involved in RTF if you have not to. Okay, if you have not. So these are the dates. Okay, we have the first session is the overview and filling of personal questionnaire on the 28th. The second session is the ministry day itself. It's on the 18th or 25th. So do sign up accordingly, because we want to be a church that is so huge so that God can use us to heal the nations, the people around us. Amen, church. Very good. The third announcement is all leaders meeting is happening on the 18th of October, 8 to 10 p.m. Let me share with you a good news. There's dinner. Wow. Everybody say, wow. That's why you look at BBTC leaders, we are of a certain stature. Because we eat, okay, and we fellowship, okay, fellowship. Very good. So all leaders, we'll see you there. If you can't, please do let your immediate leader know. Last but not least, our BBTC anniversary. If you not know, we are nearing our anniversary. We need food servers. You see, one of the things of having fellowship, okay, having food, okay, we need people that to serve. So I'm very thankful and I'm very pleased to announce that Living Stone Tribe, okay, they volunteer themselves. But do you know, no, BBTC is so big that we need more people. So we are actually asking for cell group, cluster, or perhaps tribe to come and serve during anniversary. So if this is you, and this is perhaps what you can do as a cell group, as a cluster, or even as a tribe, do sign up accordingly. So that's it for the announcement. Are you ready for the Word of God? Testing. Are you ready to worship the Lord? Yeah, very good. Come, let us all rise. And let us open up our hearts. And let's stretch forth our hands to the heavens. And say, God, here am I. Oh God, we want to surrender ourselves to you. Oh God, we want to surrender BBTC to you. We are so grateful. We are so thankful that you called us here. And as one church, we want to continue to declare that Jesus Christ, you are our Lord, you are our God, and we worship you forever and ever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's give him praise. Hallelujah.
Let's continue to clap to him, shall we? Let's raise a joyful noise. Let's celebrate Jesus. Woo! I'm excited to worship the Lord. Let's sing to the Lord with this very familiar song, shall we?
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So love he the world that he gave us his son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. We praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he has done.
Oh, perfect.
Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood. To every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes, that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord,
people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. Praise the Lord, we praise the Lord. Let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, we praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He has done. And give Him the glory, great things He has done. And give Him the glory, great things He has done. Let's give Him praise. Woo! Praise You, Lord. Let's celebrate Jesus. Sing all with me. Joyful voice, every heart in our heart sings and adores. We will stand at Your gates with thankful songs. You are good and Your faithfulness is sure. We enter Your gates with praise, that all the nations sing. Great is Our God, Your name it shall endure. We are forever Yours, we fill Your courts with praise. Great is Our God, Your love it shall endure. Sovereign Christ is our Lord and God alone. We will stand at Your gates with thankful songs. In Your grace, our Lord Jesus, we're secure. Let's declare this, we belong to Him. We are forever Yours.
forever yours. Here we go, enter your gates and praise, let all the nations sing. The greatest of God, your name, it shall endure. We are forever yours, we fill your cups with praise. Proclaim that we belong to our Lord. We belong to you, Lord. We are forever yours. Let's proudly proclaim, we are forever yours. And all the saints, let's proclaim, we are forever yours, our Lord. We are forever yours. Tell the Lord we belong to you. We are forever yours. We were born by you. We are forever yours. Yes, we are. We are forever yours. Forever yours. As the music plays, church, gonna give you a moment now between you and your master. As we have sung, we belong to him. Tell the Lord on your own that you belong to him. You were created by him, and you were bought and ransomed with the blood of Christ. Tell the Lord, acknowledge his lordship again. We are yours, we are yours. Come and be our king. Be magnified, Lord. Be glorified. Jesus, Lord Jesus, yeah. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols. You give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lend our souls to another. You give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh yeah. We turn our eyes to you, Lord. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees. Oh Spirit, come make us humble.
we cast down our idols. You give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. You give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. You give us clean hands, give us pure hearts, oh Lord. Let us not lift our souls to another. You give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks, who seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. We seek your face, we seek you, Lord. All we want is you, Lord. All we want is you, Lord. Turn our eyes away from these evil things. Turn our eyes to you, oh Lord. Turn our eyes to you, Lord. Turn your people to you, Lord. You captured us, oh generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be. Seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God of Jacob.
It's Lord this afternoon. As your body, Lord Jesus Christ, we cry out, we proclaim, Lord, we seek your face. Turn our eyes from all other things of this world. Turn our eyes to you, O Lord. Even right now, by faith, we know that you are here. Lord, open our hearts and our minds to encounter you for ourselves. Come and move as you wish, Lord. Come and move. Let's tell the Lord again.
Oh God, let us be a generation that sees and seeks your face, oh God of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that sees,
who seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that sees, who seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob, oh God, let us be a generation that sees, who seeks your face. Oh God of Jacob.
Forever, Your goodness is forever. Your mercy is forever. Forever.
Forever.
Your kindness is forever. Your goodness is forever. Your mercy is forever. Forever. Forever, your goodness is forever, your mercy is forever, forever. You are good, you are good, you are good, your mercy is forever. You are good, your mercy is forever. Your kindness is forever. Your goodness is forever. Your mercy is forever. Forever. Your kindness is forever. Your goodness is forever. Your mercy is forever, forever. Let's give it praise. How good, Lord. Hey. Let's praise Jesus. We lift you up, Lord. Lord Jesus. Cast my mind into Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid Him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. On the third and break of dawn, the Son of Heaven rose again. Oh, trample death, where is your sting? The angels roar for Christ the King. Praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh Lord our God. Oh, praise.
The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Hallelujah, we bless you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, please be seated. Let us prepare our hearts for the Holy Communion. Join me as we peel off the first layer. And let's hold on to the bread. And let us pray. Thank you, Jesus. We praise you and we worship you because you are worthy. You give of yourself for us, your body that was broken for us, so that, Lord, we may see you, so that we may experience you, so that we may receive forgiveness and to be with you forever. For that, Lord, we are grateful and thankful. Even as we partake of the bread, we want to partake in your divine nature for your glory, in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, let's partake of the bread. Let's peel off the next layer. And let us hold on to the cup. And let us pray. Jesus, we praise your holy name. You pour out your blood for us. You cover us so that, Lord, we may receive the remission of our sins. The Lord, once again, Lord, even as we partake of this cup, we want to be covered by your blood again and again. So that, Lord, that we are fit for your service. We overcome the evil one. We do all things to the glory of Jesus Christ. We bless you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's partake of the cup. Let's continue the posture, even as we give our tithe and offering. Join me in prayer. Thank you, Jesus. You give us your all. Teach us to also give you our all. for you deserve all the glory, all the honor. We can never outgive you, but we want to give with that cheerful heart, knowing that it is your grace that's being poured out in our life. And even as we give in faith that you will use it for the extension of your eternal kingdom till we meet you face to face again, our Lord Jesus. We bless you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Church, for the ways that you can give to the Lord, you can refer to the screen. Usually, I would say you can refer to the screens, but I only got one screen. It's a hint. Maybe be generous with us so that we can have better visual effect for BBTC. Just a reminder, perhaps some of you guys, you are still wondering, where is the left and the right screen? Just to share that BBTC, we are going through renovation, as you can see around the church. We just want to upgrade. We want to be faithful steward of the gifts that God has given us through the church so that we can experience God with some of these visual effects and for the propagation of His gospel. So thank you. The Lord love a cheerful giver. Once again, I want to welcome every one of you in the house of God. And perhaps this is your first time, second time, or third time you have not connected with any one of us. Just to let you know that we have a newcomer booth all the way behind. It's blue, it's cool, it's shining. So do join us. Every week we do have people to come over to our newcomer booth. We will chit-chat with them. We will share with them more about the church. And more importantly, we have a free gift for you. Okay, so come and enjoy the free gift, enjoy the fellowship, and make this place the church that you can come weekly. And of course, those of you who are watching online, we miss you. Do join us on site soon. You know who I'm talking about. Okay, so for congregational prayer, today we're going to pray for children. We just finished a whole weekend. No, in fact, this is the weekend of Children's Day weekend. So we're going to pray for our children. We're going to pray for these three P's: passion, purity, and protection. So may I invite all of you to stand up. This is what we're going to do. If you have children, pray for your children. If you have no children, pray for our Kids for Christ children. Our children pastors at the front. And if you want to pray some more, you can pray for your favorite children, your nephew, your niece. Okay, so that Jesus said, let the children come to me. So let us pray. Count to three for the next 30 seconds. 1, 2, 3. Come, let's pray. You can pray alone, pray as a couple, pray as a family, pray as a cell group. Let's pray. I'll close in 10 seconds time. Come join me in prayer. Oh Abba Father, you are our Abba Father. We are your children. Lord, the words of Jesus say, let the children come to Him. And Lord, even as your children, we want to come to you. We want to surrender our old children. We want to surrender the children of BBTC. We want to surrender perhaps some of our favorite children from our loved ones and friends. Lord, it is our desire that they will know Jesus Christ. They will experience Jesus. And their life will never be the same again because they know that God loved them. And they in turn will love people, so that Lord, that they will be used by you for end time purposes, so that by the love that we demonstrate for one another, from the young to the old, people will know that God, you are real you are in our midst. And this is our prayer. We bless you, our Abba Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Next, we're going to have our congregational prayer. Correction, scripture meditation. Today, my battery is a bit flat. I need to go charge up with some steamboat later. Okay, anyway, scripture meditation. We're going to read the reference, the verse and the reference. Very good. Take a deep breath. 1, 2, 3. Hebrews 9:14. How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our conscience from the acts that leads to death, so that we may serve the living God. Hebrews 9:14. The Lord bless the public reading of his word. Ladies and gentlemen, are you ready for the word of God? Make some noise for our deputy senior pastor, Pastor Edric Sung, on the topic on Jesus, the superior sacrifice.
Pastor Jeff, enjoy your steamboat. Why never invite us? There's 500 people, hungry people here waiting to be fed. Okay, we are going to be learning about Jesus and the superior sanctuary this weekend. And just nice, we have a nice reminder that even how, no matter how nice our sanctuary is, it will always be inferior at times. That we got to, on this earth, it can always get better. You know, things are never as perfect as you are. And what we've learned in the whole course of the study of Hebrews, I hope you've been enjoying this, I've been enjoying this a lot, is we have learned that Jesus is superior. Jesus is superior. So, Jesus is superior to the angels. Jesus is superior to mere men. Even the great men, they are inferior to him. Men like Moses and Joshua. Jesus is the superior high priest. Jesus is the mediator of a superior new covenant. Right? So in a nutshell, Jesus is superior. Very good. And today in Hebrews chapter 9, we'll be learning that Jesus ushers us into, gives us access, has access to the superior sanctuary or the superior tabernacle. And the reason he has access to that and can grant us access to that is because Jesus is the superior sacrifice. Okay? So, I have a lot to get through today. So, let me open us in a word of prayer and let's get right to it. Father God, we just thank you so much for this wonderful book of Hebrews through which we learn in such depth and such detail that truly the gift that you give us, the gift of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, is superior. Far greater than the things of this earth. Far greater than any man of this earth is our Lord Jesus Christ. And through this study, the past few weeks, the weeks to come, and even today here as we listen, help us to grasp in our heart of hearts that Jesus, you're the best. You are perfect. You're superior. Teach us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Everyone, turn to the person next to you and say this phrase. I give you a friendly pronunciation guide. Okay, I lead you through, okay? Let's go one word. Kag, Sukkot, Sameach. Okay, now turn to the person next to you and say, Kag, Sukkot, Sameach. What is, now, good, now we're all Jewish experts. And by the way, I should just plug BBTC Academy, which is for people who have, you know, completed the GDT, NDT, MDT, right? We are going to embark on a study of basic Hebrew. Right, so there you are, you have already passed your opening test. Now you can sign up for BBTC Academy's Hebrew lessons. What does Kag Sukkot Sameach mean? It means happy Sukkot holiday. And the reason you say that to each other is because right now we are at the tail end of a festival that has just completed this morning maybe in Israel, which is the festival of Sukkot. The Feast of Tabernacles. Unfortunately, for those of you who follow the news, it is not such a happy holiday because just over the last 24 hours or so, there have been a lot of attacks, rockets, 5,000 rockets launched into parts of Israel, etc. So the end of this particular holiday has not been so happy for them. But for the past week or so, Jews, especially in Israel, but around the world, but especially in Israel, have been celebrating this Feast of Tabernacles, which is Sukkot. In fact, about half a year ago, I asked SP, I really want to preach about Sukkot, right? And it turns out, just nicely, Hebrews chapter 9 is about a tabernacle. And here we are learning about it on this week of the Feast of Tabernacles. Okay, so what is this Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot? It's a week-long Jewish festival. This year, it starts from the Day of Atonement, just after the Day of Atonement, which is Yom Kippur. Started this year, September 29th, and it ended around somewhere this morning, depending on how you count your hours, right? Sometimes there's an eighth day added to the week of Sukkot, in which case we'll be in that eighth day now. And in the traditional agrarian economy, agrarian society of the Jews, this would have marked the end of the harvest. So the harvest season is over. In Exodus 23:16, it says there's a feast of ingathering, so they're gathering in all the harvest. And this was a significant time in the Jewish calendar. You look through the Bible, various things happen on this season, in this Sukkot season, the Feast of Tabernacles, such as the dedication of Solomon's Temple, when the Jews gathered back in Israel, in Jerusalem after the exile. That was on the Feast of Tabernacles, when they first read the Word of God. If you remember in the time of Ezra, the Word of God, the Word of the Law was hidden. They didn't know where it went, and they finally surfaced it, and they read it with great tears, with great rejoicing on Sukkot in Ezra chapter 8. And this is what this festival is all about. This is taken from Leviticus chapter 23, from the law. And it says, on the 15th day of the 7th month, some of you will ask, it is not the 15th of July. This is the Hebrew calendar, the Jewish calendar, so they are a bit different from ours. So on the 15th day of the 7th month of the Jewish calendar, the festival of tabernacles begins, and it will last for 7 days. So on the first day, you take branches from luxuriant trees, palm trees, willow trees, whatever leafy trees you can find, and rejoice before the Lord your God for 7 days. During these 7 days, you live in temporary shelters. And these shelters, the word they use is a sukkah, that's a singular, sukkot is plural. And basically it means it's a tent, it's a booth. Back then in those days, I just clarified with our Hebrew expert, Elder Leon, a tabernacle basically just meant a tent. Right? So hence, the Feast of Tabernacles is a feast of tents. Why tents? Because all native-born Israelites will live in these temporary shelters so that your descendants will know that I had the Israelites live in temporary shelters when I brought them out of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Okay, so you catch that. The reason they're living in tents is to remember the deliverance by God. As they were delivered from slavery from Egypt, they lived. They were 40 years in the wilderness. They couldn't build permanent housing. They couldn't erect a great big structure. What they could do is they would live in tents, which they would put up and tear down when they had to move. Put up and tear down when they would have to move. Okay, so that's the Feast of Booths, the Feast of Tabernacles, where for 7 days they live in a tent to remember their deliverance from Egypt. And it will look like any of these. On the left, for example, is a more basic model, shall we say. Okay? You just get some sticks, get some leaves, put it together, and you are supposed to stay there for 7 days. Normally, they'll say you stay there and you can look at the stars through it, right? Now, in modern-day Israel, you know, they still observe these laws. So many of them will have somewhat nicer, but nonetheless still temporary and makeshift structures. Right, so wherever they have space, out on the street, in their balcony, just in front of their house, behind their house, they would set up a temporary structure, sticks and leaves. Of course, if you are a slightly richer Jew of greater means, you can set up something a little bit nicer. You can go glamping out in your garden. But it's a temporary structure. So for 7 days, for 1 week a year, they would celebrate through temporary structures, in slightly ramshackle circumstances, but in that moment, they will celebrate the deliverance, the goodness of God, okay? So, what does this have to do with Hebrews chapter 9? Hebrews chapter 9 talks to us about the tabernacle. And the original tabernacle in the book of the law, the original tabernacle was a tent. Remember I said the word tabernacle basically means a tent, right? And back in the day, before they had the temple of Solomon, etc., wherever they went in the wilderness, they would set up the tent. The tent would be their temple. But it's a makeshift structure. It was cloth, it was sticks. They would carry some nicer things here and there, but they would have to be able to take it down, build it up, tear it down, build it up, tear it down. A temporary structure, a tent. So Hebrews chapter 9 says, now the first covenant had regulations for worship and also an earthly sanctuary. So straight away, the writer of Hebrews reminds us that in that time, all of you Jews, even as you marvel at what happened before, remember that even though all the instructions are laid on how to build the tabernacle, it is still an earthly sanctuary. It's a temporary dwelling. It is nothing great, so to speak, right? It's inferior to to the heavenly options, right? And so what does this tabernacle look like? It's set up, and in the first room were the lampstand and table with consecrated bread. So the outer room, the bigger room, is called the holy place. And then you go in through a curtain from the first room into an inside room. So and that's called the most holy place. So you go from the courtyard to the first room, the holy place, in the inner room called the most holy place. And in that most holy place, there was the golden altar of incense, the gold-covered ark of the covenant, the gold jar of manna inside the ark, the Aaron's staff that had budded, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Right, and on the ark, above the ark are the cherubim, like little angels carved out, which are the glory. They overshow the atonement cover. But we cannot discuss these things in detail now, which is a good phrase to use. So let me just discuss these briefly to help you picture what we have just learned. This is roughly what the tabernacle would have looked like. So wherever they were in the wilderness, they'll set up camp, and then they'll set up this tabernacle in the middle of the million-plus Jews walking around the wilderness, right? It is... if you see the scale over there, if that's an American football field, I don't know how big American football field, so the green rectangle is a soccer pitch, right? The court of the tabernacle is about that big. So we're maybe talking about 1/6, 1/8 the size of a football field, maybe the size of our HQ downstairs, our open atrium, roughly that kind of space for the courtyard of the tabernacle. Courtyard, on the outside area, there's the altars, there's a brazen laver, like a big bowl for washing, etc. And then you've got the tent, the tabernacle. And what you see there is there's an inner room, there's an outer room and an inner room. The holy place and the most holy place, right? And let me zoom in a little bit on the holy of holies, the most holy place. If you can see there, the numbers 1 and 2 there. Inside the most holy place, there would be the Ark of the Covenant. This is just a rendition, a drawing based on how it's described in the Bible. And inside the Ark of the Covenant, there would be the gold jar of manna. In this picture, I don't know why they didn't put it in a jar, but anyway, imagine a gold jar of manna, which we don't exactly know what manna is, so something that looks a little bit like unleavened bread. Aaron's staff that had budded, and stone tablets. Now, this is not the actual Ark of the Covenant and the actual contents of the Ark of the Covenant. Those are lost in time. This is just someone's depiction of what is in the Ark of the Covenant. Okay, so this is what where we are so far. The writer of the book of Hebrews is describing the earthly tabernacle, the earthly sanctuary. And then he continues, when everything had been arranged like this, the priests entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. So people might be, let's say, coming to the courtyard, bringing sacrifices, bringing offerings. The priests could enter from the courtyard into that first room, the outer room, and they could carry on their ministry. But that inner room, barely anyone would ever set foot inside the inner room. Only the high priest entered the inner room, and that only once a year. That would be on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. And never without blood, for he offered for himself and for the sins which he offered for himself and for the sins the people had committed in ignorance. So, for this one person to enter the most holy place into the very presence of God, where the Ark of the Covenant is and the Spirit of God hovering over between the cherubim on the Ark of the Covenant, one day a year, and only one person, and only under certain conditions. You have to shed blood, offer blood up, you know, to offer for the sins of yourself and for other people, etc. So a very limited access, a very exclusive room. I think last week when Elder David was sharing about it, he mentioned that actually that room was completely dark because it's shrouded around behind a curtain, behind another curtain, right, behind the tent, right? So this priest would go in there, entering to the dark one day a year. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had not yet been disclosed as long as the first tabernacle was still functioning. So it is designed like this by design. The very act of it being so difficult to enter was a design by the Holy Spirit to show that even this way of entering into the presence of God is inferior. It is imperfect. And when God does that, it is to bring about later on a perfect way, a superior way. So right now where we are at is, if you are functioning under this first tabernacle, if you are the Jews still wandering around the wilderness, if you are still setting up temporary shelters, it is an inferior way. There is a better way that revelation has to come upon you for. Okay? This is an illustration for the present time, indicating that the gifts and the sacrifices being offered were not able to clear the conscience of the worshipper. And so what the writer of the book of Hebrews is saying, sure, bring your offerings, sure, bring your sacrifices, but it will never, ever, ever be able to fully purify your heart, your soul, your conscience. It'll go some distance. I mean, it's a day of atonement. You atone to a degree, to a level. But what happens the next day when you sin again? And you go get one whole year again before the high priest enters on the day of atonement again, for example, right? So no matter what happens under this old way of doing things, this earthly sanctuary, this earthly tabernacle, whatever is being done to offer up to God, it's not enough to clear your conscience. Why? Because they are just food. They are just drink. They are just ceremonial washings. They are just external regulations. You can cleanse on the outside, but for atonement, for forgiveness, while looking for something deep on the inside. You can take any number of baths that you want and you'll be very clean on the outside, but no number of baths you take can clean you on the inside, right? So things that are external have limited ability to redeem, to atone. But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and the more perfect tabernacle that is not made with human hands. That is to say, it's not a part of this creation. So before Christ personified, there was a tabernacle, there was a high priest. But when Christ comes, he comes going through a more perfect tabernacle. Not made with human hands as the old one was, but something that is not even part of the creation. This access to God is there before creation, because God exists before creation. And Jesus does not enter by the means of goats and cows. He entered the most holy place once and for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkle on those who are ceremonially unclean, sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. But how much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? Human high priest, they go through a whole process of finding the firstborn, the one, the lamb, the goat, the sheep, without any blemish, the as near to a perfect, spotless sacrifice as they can find. But Jesus Christ is spotless inside and outside. He was spotless, sinless from the beginning of time to when he was on earth, to there on the cross, to the end of time. So he offers a perfect sacrifice. So whatever it is the blood of ashes and of heifers and goats and bulls can do, how much more do you imagine the perfect blood of a perfect sacrifice can do? It can, in verse 14, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death. In other words, it forgives us to the point that we don't have to pay the price of dying for our sin. That's what Hebrews 9:14 is saying. Why does all that happen? So that we may know God, so that we may serve the living God. This is the first half of Hebrews chapter 9, verses 1 to 14. Let me summarize it for you in a comparison. The earthly sanctuary versus the heavenly sanctuary. The earthly sanctuary is run by a human high priest and it's human made. They will put it up and they will tear it down. They will put it up and they will tear it down. If one day they put it up badly, it's put up badly. If one day they tear it down badly, it's torn down badly, right? But meanwhile, in verse 11, we learn that in this heavenly sanctuary, we have a divine high priest. Divine because Jesus Christ, Son of God, is the high priest. And it becomes, therefore, a divine, perfect tabernacle. Not merely a temporary resting place, but a resting place, a sanctuary, a dwelling fit for God himself. He was, remember, he said this was there even before the creation. God was there in his sanctuary. This is where God was. That's where Christ came from, right? So human high priest, divine high priest. Human made tabernacle, divine perfect tabernacle. The earthly sanctuary, the earthly tabernacle, the one that the Jews wandered around the wilderness with, it was full of reminders of the fallenness of man. Reminders of the fact that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, of our separation with God. For example, you have the altar of incense. And why is the altar of incense then? Exodus 30 teaches us you're supposed to put it there and it is there that I will meet you. It is there that I will meet you. You and I, we now know, you are taught very well in this church, you can build your altar before God anywhere. We say the phrase you hear often, you build your altar of thanksgiving, praise, and worship. You don't have to come specifically here to a designated church to build that altar. You can build that altar at your home, when you're walking to the MRT, when you're sitting in your car. That altar is wherever you want it to be built, so to speak. But there, in that time, they had to come specifically to this one place if they wanted access to God. So a reminder of man's limited access to God. The jar of manna. Now, manna was a wonderful thing that sustained the Jews through their time in the wilderness. It came out of the heavens, and after the 40 years, no one saw it ever again. It was truly a miraculous provision. But John 6 reminds us that, yes, it was good for the time, but they ate it and they still died. It is something God provided, but it's not a perfect solution. It will not sustain you forever. Right? It's a reminder of man's fallen flesh. There was Aaron's staff. In Numbers chapter 17 follows Numbers chapter 16 with the rebellion of the sons of Korah, or the rebellion of Korah, rather. In Numbers 17, they gather and they try to say, who is the appointed man of God? Who should be the leader among us? And Moses, Aaron, basically, they got every leader of every tribe to put a staff there. And they said, God will indicate to us who is the one that is the appointed man of God, the chosen spokesman of God. And so number 17, if you read number 17, only one staff budded. By right, a staff shouldn't bud. It is a chopped off tree, it's a chopped off branch. There's no right for it to still have life in it. So even the budding of Aaron's staff was a miracle. But the reason it is put in the Ark of the Covenant is as a sign to the rebellious. It's there to remind you that you are a grumbling people, that you are a people who are forever unsatisfied. You are a people that no matter how much I give you, deliverance, brought you out of Egypt, manna from the heavens, etc., still you grumble against me. So that's what the Aaron's staff is in the Ark of the Covenant for. Why are the stone tablets in there? Deuteronomy 31. Take the book of the law, place it beside the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God, and there it remains as a witness against you. The laws which are revered by the legalistic people, right? The laws are put there to remind them as a witness that they were rebellious, that they were stiff-necked. In the time of Moses, it says, if you were rebellious, even when I'm still here, how much more will you rebel when I'm not around anymore? That's how rebellious you are. So the stone tablets are there as a reminder of our separation, our fallenness, man's rebellion against God. Even the cherubim, there above the cover between the two cherubim are the Ark of the Covenant, and there I will meet with you and give you all of my commands for the Israelites. Think about it, if the Ark of the Covenant was in the tabernacle most of the time, and it was only out there when they had to take down camp, move somewhere, and then set up the camp all around it all over again. That means, and if that's where they would meet with God theoretically, I will meet with you and give you all of my commands, it means they had very little access to hear from God. So it's great that they had a tabernacle. It's great that they had a place to worship God. But in the book of Hebrews, the writer reminds us that it is still a very inferior, imperfect circumstance, a very imperfect situation. Yes, you have some access to God, but it's limited. Yes, we are not totally separated from God, but there's a lot of separation. The sin separates us. The circumstances separate us. And so, on one end, you've got the earthly sanctuary where only priests could come into the outer room and only the high priest could come into the inner room. Meanwhile, you have the heavenly sanctuary where the great high priest, who we know is our Lord Jesus Christ, he has already made the sacrifice of his own blood so that access is given to all. And now in this church, we know that we are all priests anyway, so we can enter. We have full access into that sanctuary. In the earthly sanctuary, in the old manner of the law, under the old covenant, no matter what you did, no matter how many sacrifices you bring, you would never be completely clean. You could do a lot for God. It's almost like trying to buy God's forgiveness, Like, how much do you want, God, What will it take to cleanse me? I've got a goat here, I've got a bull here, I bought this sheep from, etc., etc. They will never be able to clear it. Why? Because even the sacrifice is imperfect. And besides, today I make the sacrifice, tonight I sin. Tomorrow, I've got more forgiveness needed. I have still an unclean conscience. However, in the heavenly sanctuary, the sacrifice is perfect once and for all. The blood of Christ that cleanses our consciences from acts that lead to death. So, earthly sanctuary versus heavenly sanctuary. One is a human thing, staffed by humans, accessed by humans, who are separated from God by and large, who are fallen, with very limited access to the most holy place. How many people get to be the high priest? In fact, only one tribe could be the high priest. So that already excludes 11 other tribes, for example. And no matter what you do, never fully cleansed, never fully forgiven, never fully right before God. Versus this idea of the heavenly sanctuary in which Jesus came from and which we know He is going to bring us back to. Him, the divine high priest, giving us access one day to a divine perfect tabernacle as we are restored and redeemed and given access face to face with our Father God. Why? Because it is the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ that cleanses us, and Jesus calls us to this superior sanctuary. So in the book of Hebrews, we're talking to people who know the Jewish tradition, who know the Jewish law. They would have worshipped and celebrated at whatever their tabernacle, whatever their temple of their times were. But here the writer of the book of Hebrews is saying, good as it is, amazing as it is to have some deliverance, some access to God. Imagine if you take that and you multiply it so many much more times over, and you have a perfect version of that earthly sanctuary. Instead of this earthly, limited sanctuary with all of these loopholes and all of these, you know, it could be better. What if there was a perfect version of that? Who in their right mind would stay in a small flat when you are being offered a big house? Maybe the person who has to do all the cleaning, right? But, you know, I mean, why would you want to stay in this limited place if there is something so much better and it is being freely offered to you? That's the first half of Hebrews chapter 9. Let me continue with verse 15. So for this reason, Christ is the mediator of a new covenant. For this reason, access into this sanctuary. For this reason, He's cleansing our consciousness so that we can serve the living God. For all of these things, Christ has mediated. He has arranged a deal. He has worked it out with God of a new covenant, that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, that now that He has died as a ransom to set them free from the sins committed under the first covenant. Then we have a little bit of legal, technical aspect over here. Because for the Jews, for those Hebrews, they need the law to be satisfied, for them to be satisfied. And it says, well, in the case of a will, it's necessary to prove the death of the one who made it. Because a will is in force only when somebody has died, it never takes effect while the one who made it is living. And this is why even the first covenant was not put into effect without blood. So in other words, if we are to inherit this eternal inheritance, for it to be an inheritance, someone must have died so that the will kicks in, so that we can receive the inheritance. And what he's saying here is, legally, it has happened. Someone had to die for this to take place. And we know that that would be the death of Jesus on the cross. Right? At this point, in case you weren't here last week, we should talk a little bit about the old covenant against the new covenant. Because we've been saying this a lot. Jesus is Christ was the mediator of the new covenant. And here I just want to put everything in the very, very good words of my of Elder David Fu when he preached here last weekend. Under the old covenant, a covenant is like a contract, an agreement, a deal, right? I agree on this, you agree on this, we come into covenant based on our agreement. The old covenant under the law, on Israel's side, Israel had to make promises. Okay, God, I promise I will obey you. All that you tell me to do, I promise to obey that. I promise that you will be my only God. Now, as a human being, even as I say those words, I can feel myself being hypocritical already. I might say and mean it right now at this very moment, but it won't take long before I disobey something that God tells me to do. It won't take long before another God comes into the picture. It may not call itself God.
It might be a hobby that takes up a bit too much of my time. It might be a habit that I just can't kick, right? It may not call itself a god, but it won't be long before other gods come in. But anyway, this is what man has promised. This is what Israel has promised. Meanwhile, God's side promises to prosper, to protect Israel, promises that Israel will have a special place in God's heart. They will be His special people, right? That's the old covenant. The new covenant, which is ushered in by the death, the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, the covenant changes. Now, you notice on God's side, the yellow words there didn't change. Those things still remain. God's word doesn't change. If He wants to prosper you, He'll prosper you. If He wants to protect you, He'll protect you. If you are special to Him, you're still special to Him, right? On Israel's side, though, the understanding was under the old covenant doesn't make sense because one side is always going to let down its end of the covenant. Does that make sense? One side will never be able to live up to the deal. If, for example, my contract with Kok Guan here is I will buy his car and I'll give him $2 million for your car. This is hypothetical anyway. Deal? Deal. All right? So he gives me the car and I don't give him a cent. Not on. Not on. It's too late. I already have the car. Right? So that's the old covenant way of doing things. I want something, but I can't fully live up to my end of the agreement. And God knows that that's the problem with the old covenant. So under the new covenant, the weaker side of the deal, the man's side, Israel's side, there's nothing you need to do because it is finished, the finished work on the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. You need only believe. And when you do so, on top of all that God has already promised, He will give us three new things. And these three new things are, as Elder David pointed out, a new heart, a personal relationship, and a clean slate. And these are important because these are the reasons that even though I don't have anything to do on my end of the agreement, because I have a new heart in me, I don't want to break the law of God. I don't want to break God's heart anymore. Because I have a clean slate, I no longer have to live under the guilt and the shame of the past and my personal relationship with God. That is what makes me not want to break His heart. It's no longer about the laws. It's no longer about, oh, if I break the law, am I out of His promise, etc., etc. It's about I love God so much that whatever He says, I want to do it. And then layered upon that, under this new covenant, is He understands that we are failed, we are fallen, and sometimes we will fall short. And still His grace and His forgiveness is poured out on us. That's the new covenant that Jesus mediated on the cross for us. Okay? So, this is what we're talking about in the old covenant versus the new covenant. Back to Hebrews chapter 9. Now, when Moses had proclaimed every command of the law to all the people, then the blood kicks in. He takes the blood of calves and he mixes it with water, dilutes it a little bit, scarlet wool, branches of hyssop. He sprinkles the scroll and all the people. So right now he's got blood and he's splashing it everywhere, right? So first he sprinkles it on the scroll, then all the people, you get some blood, okay? And he says, this is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you to keep. And then he keeps doing that. He's got a lot of blood and he keeps sprinkling it. So he sprinkles with the blood both the tabernacle, so that tent, right? It gets some blood too. And everything used in the ceremony, so the laver, the this, the that, it gets some blood too. So there's blood everywhere. Remember what we read earlier? Externally meant to wash clean. So this blood is just symbolically meant to say, okay, it's purified. Okay, I bless you, I bless you, I bless you, so to speak. Okay? In fact, the law requires that nearly everything be cleansed with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. I'll explain this in a couple of slides. Let me just read on first. It was necessary then for the copies of the heavenly things to be purified with these same sacrifices, but the heavenly things themselves with better sacrifices than these. So if there was an earthly sanctuary and had to be purified with merely the blood of animals, imagine if there's a heavenly sanctuary. What would qualify as blood that would purify that, that would sanctify that? For Christ did not enter a sanctuary made with human hands that was only a copy of the true one. So the writer of Hebrews is saying, you know this tabernacle that you keep building every year, for example, during the Feast of Tabernacles, that's a copy. You talk about it being a temporary shelter to remember that God protected me, God delivered me. Imagine if instead of that being a temporary statement, that was a permanent, a forever statement. God has protected me, will protect me, has forever delivered me now and forevermore, right? So that's the earthly sanctuary, the copy, against the true one. Christ entered heaven itself now to appear for us in God's presence. Nor did he enter heaven to offer himself again and again, the way the high priest enters the most holy place every year with blood that is not his own. Right? Every year, a high priest comes, sheds, animal, and then next year he repeats the process, right? Frankly, they do that on a daily basis, the various sacrifices that they have to give it for. But that's not true for a perfect high priest. The perfect high priest will do it once and for all. Otherwise, Christ would have had to suffer many times since the creation of the world. Every time he has to appear before God to advocate for us, to plead for us, he has to sacrifice himself again and again and again. That doesn't need to be so. Why? Because he has appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. Good Friday, Resurrection Weekend, is the center point of history. That's what this verse is saying. The culmination of ages. Everything leading up in history, up to the Mount of Calvary, that was all setting the stage for everything to make sense. And everything that has happened since then, it only makes sense because of the work, finished work of Christ on the cross and the empty tomb. And so just as people are destined to die once and after that to face judgment, so Christ was sacrificed once. We don't need to die many times over. Christ doesn't need to die many times over because he is Christ. His one death will take away the sins of many. How many? All who believe, all who will call on his name, all who will cry out to him for forgiveness. He didn't just appear that one time. He will appear a second time. Not to bear sin as he did on the cross, but bearing sin is just, I forgive your sin right now. But the second time when it says to bring salvation to those who are waiting for him, remember this is the second coming of the Christ. So this phrase, to bring salvation to those who are waiting, is forever saved. Bring salvation is forever saved. When he comes again, those of us who are still in Christ, we will forevermore be reconciled with him, with Father God, in the holy place, in the most holy place, in heaven itself. Right? So, back to the blood. There's a lot of blood in this chapter, and frankly, in a lot of Hebrews, there's a lot of blood. This is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you to keep. This is from Exodus chapter 24. And Exodus 24 is just after the revealing, the reading of all of the laws. Exodus 20 was the first Ten Commandments, when the Ten Commandments were first rolled out. Moses told all the people, all of the Lord's words and laws, and they responded, everything the Lord has said, we will do. Right? So Moses took half the blood, put it in the bowls, the other half, he put it in the altar. And then he took the book of the covenant, he read it to people, and they responded, we will do everything the Lord has said, we will obey. So first, he has sprinkled blood on the altar, he has sprinkled blood on the copies of the things of God. Now, after the people say, we will obey, then he takes the blood, he sprinkles it on the people, and he says, what was quoted in Hebrews chapter 9, this is the blood of the covenant which God commanded you to keep in accordance with all of these words of the law. So, to explain what's going on here, under the old covenant, God had a command, and Israel made a promise to obey the command, right? We saw that earlier when we talked about old covenant versus new covenant. Blood is sprinkled because it's a contract. It's an agreement between you and me, two parties here. So blood is sprinkled to seal one side of the contract. Okay, I sign my name here. And then it's sprinkled on the other side of the contract. Okay, I sign my name here. Now both of our signatures, so to speak, are on the contract. The problem, as we saw earlier, is that one side of the party can keep his word. So no matter how much blood you sprinkle, the God side is done. He's God. His word will be true. His word never returns to him void. What he says is final. It's yes and amen, right? The problem is no matter how much blood you sprinkle on the people, they are not good enough to keep up their end of the agreement. The words that we said, we will obey. Everything you have said, we will obey. They mostly did not obey. We mostly do not obey. So, and then in verse 22, it says, the law requires that everything be cleansed with blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Now, the law refers here to Leviticus 17, verse 11. For the life of a creature is in the blood. I've given it to you to make atonement for yourselves on the altar. It is the blood that makes atonement for one's life. So this is God's word. He says, blood must be shed for forgiveness. Blood has to be shed. It is lifeblood to redeem your life, to spare you from death. Life has to be given for life. So we have a problem under this old covenant. We have an imperfect sacrifice, merely an animal, merely a goat, merely a sheep. We have an imperfect covenant. One end of the covenant, one signatory is perfect. The other side, we cannot keep up our end of the deal. And therefore, the covenant, that particular contract is destined to fail. Finally, we have an imperfect atonement. So you have a guy who comes, a high priest, and he will, every year, in a day of atonement, he'll try to atone for your sin, atone for your sin, atone for your sin. Right? So that was the current situation under the old tabernacle. What if we want perfect atonement? A permanent forgiveness? A permanent being set free from guilt, from shame, from the curse of sin, from the judgment of sin for once and for all? To do that, we need a perfect covenant. And as we saw, to have a perfect covenant, you have to take the imperfect party out of the deal. God has to do the finished work on the cross. And for that to happen, we will need a perfect sacrifice. Better than mere animals. Blood that is shed that will never see sin, that will never know evil. Sinless, spotless sacrifice. And we know that comes in the form of our Lord Jesus on the cross. Where there are animal sacrifices, let me just zip through all of these. Oops. There is access to a copy of heaven. But with Jesus, we have access into true heaven. Because that's where he came from. With animal sacrifice, there is blood. But the high priest isn't even shedding his own blood. He's just grabbing a nearby animal, shedding that. But the atoning blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, he shed his own blood knowing that that blood is perfect. And where with animals, you got to do it year after year, day after day. With Jesus, that sacrifice is made, not by us, but by him, once and for all. Jesus doesn't need to be re-crucified every time we sin. With animals, the sacrifice are needed to pay for every person's sin. So if I commit a sin, I got to get some animals. If you commit a sin, you better get some animals. You know, everyone bring your animals here. One by one, we'll go through the process. But our Lord Jesus Christ, so perfect, so superior, that his one sacrifice will take away the sins of many. With the animal sacrifice, the focus is on the sin. I'm guilty. I because of this, I'm separated from God. Woe is me. With Jesus' sacrifice, it says there, why did he do this? He did this to bring people with him into salvation forevermore at his second coming. And so in this, we see that in every way, the sacrifice of Jesus is superior. Whether it's the sureness of the sacrifice, not just a heaven, not just an earthly tabernacle, but to heaven itself, the source of the sacrifice, Jesus Christ himself, the scale of the sacrifice, once and for all, the subject of the sacrifice, Christ himself, the Son of God who did that, and the significance of the sacrifice, not just forgiveness for today's sins, but salvation forevermore. In every way, the sacrifice of Jesus is superior. And the writer of Hebrews presents that to the Jews. Why would you want the inferior way? Why would you want to be stuck in your old ways? Why would you want to celebrate an earthly sanctuary, an earthly tabernacle made of sticks, made of leaves, when heaven awaits, when heaven is on offer? Why won't you accept access into the superior sanctuary through the superior sacrifice of our Lord Jesus Christ? Let me give you an illustration, a slightly modern-day illustration for this. Unfortunately, you have racked up a $10,000 credit card bill. Congratulations on having even $10,000 credit. That's not bad, right? But you had a big spending, you had a bad month, you owe all of this money, and you can't pay it back right away. Because, you know, you have a monthly salary, and every month you got to pay for your groceries, you got to pay for your this, that, and the other. Finally, you say, you know what, I think I can afford a $400 monthly repayment. Which is okay. You think, I'll chip away at it over time. But what you don't factor in, of course, is the fact that on a $10,000 credit card bill, your monthly interest is 25, 26, 27% per annum, whatever it is. And that's a $400 monthly interest, let's say. So no matter how long you work, no matter how much you try to pay off this debt, you cannot pay off this debt. Even if I try to pay off this debt today, and maybe this month I manage to pay a bit more, but during that month, I use my credit card to buy some groceries. I use the credit card to you know, pay for this, that, and the other, and it goes back up again. And no matter what you do, you just cannot pay off that debt. And you are at your wit's end, and you don't know what to do, until someone comes along, and he says, I can see you're really struggling. Maybe it's Chinese New Year. You visited this auntie you never visited in 50 years or whatever. And, you know, but she says, oh, so poor thing. Here's $10,000. And you and I will know, with that $10,000, you pay off the credit card bill and your debt, there's no more debt. You are freed from that particular debt. Now, BBTC does not preach prosperity gospel, okay? I'm not saying you go back and there's a $10,000 bill awaiting, although maybe, who knows, I don't know. But that's not the point, it's an illustration, right? The debt is our sin, okay? Right? So Jesus, the death of Jesus is the payment for once and for all. We on our own, we cannot pay that debt. The sins that we have accrued, we will continue to pile up sins while we still remain in this fallen body, in this fallen world. The only way for that debt of sin to be paid up fully is if someone pays it up fully for us. A perfect payer, a perfect benefactor, a perfect sacrifice into the perfect who gives us access to the superior sanctuary. So Jesus invites us, calls us, gives us access to a superior sanctuary at his second coming, as Hebrews chapter 9 reminds us. How does he do that? He paid the price, he bought the ticket, he cleared your debt by giving his life as the superior sacrifice. And the writer of the book of Hebrews has hammered this home chapter after chapter. All of the ways in which Jesus' sacrifice is better. It is able to pay the price. He is the mediator of a better covenant by which you are not at the losing end, by which you can finally get what we all want, which we want to be reunited with Father God in heaven, in that superior sanctuary. And the writer of the book of Hebrews, as he makes these arguments, as he drives home the point, he says, it's done. Jesus died on the cross. Many of you may have seen it in person for yourself back then, in the time of the book of Hebrews. If you didn't see it, maybe your relative did, your cousin did, maybe your friend did. Maybe they were standing there at the foot of Calvary. Who knows which side they were on, but they saw Jesus die. So he says, that work is finished. They also saw the empty tomb. And for those of you who are not familiar with what happened to our Lord Jesus Christ, he died on the cross. He was definitely dead. They tested his deadness. He gave up his life. He gave up his last breath. They put him into a tomb, and there was a stone covering it that no one could have moved that stone away. And one day, 3 days later, they realized the stone was rolled away and the body was no longer there. And in the days that followed, this man, Jesus, who they knew to be dead, they saw his resurrected body, and many of them interacted with it. Proof, evidence of a risen king. So the writer of the book of Hebrews, he says, Jesus calls us to this superior sanctuary. He came once, he's coming again, and he's bringing salvation. How does he get there? He gave his life, a superior sacrifice. And he says, what are you going to do with this knowledge? Now that you know that you don't have to go around offering up bulls and goats, you don't have to go around every year with a sham, with a mockery of what a safety and a tabernacle looks like, will you receive the gift of eternal life that comes through our Lord Jesus Christ? Which brings us back to this past week, Sukkot, the Feast of Tabernacles. Jesus spoke at the Feast of Tabernacles. So we are now in 2023, but way back then, however you want to calculate it, you know, in the early 80s, right? Jesus in John chapter 7 appeared at the Feast of Tabernacles at the temple in Jerusalem. When it first started, he wasn't there, but halfway through the festival, the Feast of Tabernacles, Jesus went up to the temple courts and he began to preach. So right on this day, right on this week in history, 2,000 years ago, Jesus was at the temple courts at the Feast of Tabernacles, and he was teaching. And I need you to use your imagination now to picture what it was like. We're in a very nice sanctuary. It was nothing like that at the time. Back then, 2,000 years ago. So, the Feast of Tabernacles, Sukkot, it is one of three annual pilgrimage festivals that the Jews observe. Pilgrimage meaning that they would go back to Jerusalem, that they'll all gather again back at the temple, right? So all the Jews would come to the Jerusalem temple bringing tithes on Pesach, on Shavuot, and on Sukkot. So at least these three times a year, they would all gather at the temple in Jerusalem. This time round, though, they don't stay at their friend's house, they don't stay at the inn, they don't stay at the hotel. Because it is Sukkot, as they come, they stay in Sukkot, right? Which is the booths, which is the tabernacles, which is the temporary tent, the temporary earthly sanctuary that they'll set up made of branches and leaves, right? So they'll all come, and somewhere by the highways, by the byways, by the street sides, on the outskirts, they will set up their little tents, their little tabernacles, and they will stay there for the 7 days of Sukkot, right? So if you imagine Jesus as he comes to the temple, he's walking past all of these earthly tabernacles. And everyone he's speaking to for the last 3, 4, 5, 6 days, they have been sleeping under the stars in that little makeshift tent, right? As we learn from Leviticus 23, they're supposed to live in these temporary shelters for 7 days. I said Sukkot is a seven-day, it's a week-long festival, but they add on an extra day at the end of the festival, right? So they stay there normally for 8th day, which is known as Simchat Torah. Simchat Torah basically means the joy of reading the law. So they've stayed there in their temporary dwellings, in the temporary tabernacles for 7 days. On the 8th day, what the Jews do is they read through the book of the law once a year. Every day, they have prescribed passages that they'll read. So today might be Genesis chapter 1. Tomorrow might be Genesis chapter 2, for example. What we now know as Genesis 1 and 2, right? Back then, they would read through it. And it was on Simchat Torah, at the end of Sukkot, where the annual cycle of the reading of the law would come to an end. And it comes to an end, of course, at the end of the Pentateuch, the first five books of the Bible. So they'll read the end up all the way up to Deuteronomy chapter 33. So on that day, at that festival, or at the end of Sukkot, they will read from Deuteronomy 14 and 16 on Simchat Torah. And these chapters talk about how there is a cancelling of debts. All slaves are to be freed. Deuteronomy 14, 15, 16 talks about how firstborn animals are to be set aside as the best sacrifices. There's good sacrifices, but there's best sacrifices. It talks about how to prepare the Passover feast. And they read Deuteronomy 33, 34, which we know is at the end of the first five books. And that's the death and the burial of Moses. We know Moses is most strongly associated with the law. It is through Moses that God first gave the law. So in this time, when Jesus was teaching, everyone there is reading about the death of the giver of the law. The man who brought the law, now my servant Moses is dead. Also during Sukkot, the middle few days of Sukkot, is something called a little ceremony called Simchat Beit Hashoava. It is a water libation ceremony, a water drawing and pouring ceremony. And what they'll do is the priest will go all the way up to the pool of Siloam in the city of David, the old city of David, and they would draw water from that pool, and then they'll go down to the temple, the altar at the temple, and they will pour the water out there. And because this was the end of the harvest, they'll start praying for rain for the next harvest, right? So the reason they do this water libation ceremony is because is accompanied by the reading of these verses. Isaiah 12, 2 and 3 says, so they are reading out loud in the temples, they are reading out loud at the city of David, surely God is my salvation, I will trust and not be afraid. The Lord Himself is my strength and my defense, He has become my salvation. And with joy you will draw water from the wells of salvation. So they're supposed to go about this ceremony with great joy. If you Google this water libation ceremony, this Simchat Beit Hashoava, you're supposed to be, it's the greatest rejoicing you will find on the Jewish calendar, apparently. Even if you're not feeling happy, you force a smile and you hurrah your way through this water ceremony because it says with joy, you draw water. But they took it so literally, you know. They went and drew water from a well and they went and poured water at the altar. Drew water from the well, pour water at the altar. Where's the salvation? Salvation is coming. Also, in this time, You got to admire them. They really like reading the Torah. Also on this time, on the final day of the Feast of Tabernacles, that would be the seventh day, they read Psalm 118. And Psalm 118 is, the day is known as Hoshana Rabbah. And the reason for that is because the passage that they read, the end of Psalms 118 says this: "The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. The Lord has done it this day. Let us rejoice today and be glad." And the verse ends, the chapter ends with, "Lord, save us. Lord, save us. Lord, save us." That's Hoshana, Hosanna. Save us, save us. And they call this day Hoshana Rabbah because they are looking forward to an ultimate salvation. To a day when they don't have to do this every year. To a day when the things of this earth will pass away. They're looking forward to some idea of a great salvation. So Hoshana Rabbah is a cry for permanent, for lasting, for the ultimate salvation. And this is where you've been listening to me for a while now. I'm going to make you all do something for me, right? These two blocks here, you will shout three times, Hosanna. First time you shout it, the remaining blocks here reply, "Lord, save us." Okay? So you will shout, "Hosanna," and you all will shout, "Lord, save us." Hosanna, and then, "Lord, save us." Okay? So I'm doing this so that you have a context, a sense of where Jesus was in the middle of this Feast of Tabernacles as he started to speak, to teach, and he would declare who he was amidst this particular context. So imagine, put yourself in the right frame of mind. Your hands are a bit wet because you just came from the water pouring ceremony. In your mind, you've got a leaf in your hand, a willow leaf, a palm leaf, whatever it is. Your back is a bit, not because I've been preaching too long, but because of the temporary shelter that you stayed in, right? And now everyone raises together and they are shouting, "Hosanna, save us. Hosanna, save us." Can we do that? Okay, 1, 2, 3. Wait. Can be louder lah. Hosanna, no. You're crying out for salvation. Okay? So really mean it. Really mean it, okay? Hosanna. 1, 2, 3.
Hosanna.
Lord, save us.
Hosanna.
Lord, save us.
Hosanna. Lord, save us.
And in the middle of all of that, this is when Jesus stands up on the last and the greatest day of the festival. Everyone is out there saying, "Hosanna Rabbah." In their mind, they're thinking of a great salvation. In their mind, they have seen the water being poured out from well to altar. And all this while, they're thinking of salvation. And at this point, Jesus says something which makes it all make sense. He says, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." All of this water being poured around, but you'll be thirsty as soon as you leave that ceremony. All of this water being drawn from a well, and it will quench your thirst at this moment, but you're going to be thirsty the day after. All of this crying out for salvation. This is what Jesus is saying. Whoever believes in me, as scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them. And he says all this on Sukkot, in the festival of the tabernacles. And as he says this, what he's really saying, what Jesus is telling all of the Moses followers, all of the law followers around him, he's saying, why settle for an earthly tabernacle when I have prepared for you, when I am here to give you access to a superior heavenly sanctuary? He's saying to them, why settle for a fragile booth? 7 days later, you set up for 7 days, you pray that it stays intact for 7 days, you take it down again. When this heavenly sanctuary I come and bring you is built around a cornerstone. Why settle for merely an annual pilgrimage? Once a year, you come in, once a year, you cry out, then the next year, you repeat that over and over again. When I give you permanent access to God. Why settle for following a law that condemns? When I am here, I am the Word made flesh, the living Word. Why settle for water that can never fully quench your thirst? When Jesus says, with me, you need never thirst again. Through me, rivers of living water, which is the Holy Spirit, can flow from you, through you, in you. This is the choice that Jesus was giving and which was explained by the writer of the book of Hebrews. That if Jesus, he sees what people are living with, what people are living in, and for thousands of years they may have been doing it, and Jesus came to call them away from these old ways, away from these fragile earthly ways, to a superior sanctuary by giving his life as the superior sacrifice. And as in the time of Jesus crying out in the temple courts, and in the time of the writing of the book of Hebrews, why strive for the earthly tabernacle when a heavenly sanctuary awaits? That same question is posed to all of us today. There is an earthly way that leads to death, or there is a heavenly sanctuary that awaits us, because the King of Heaven has bought us access to that sanctuary. And the question is for us today: which will we choose? Jesus died to save you from your sins. Your sins need count against you no more. As you are saved from your sins, the greatest reward is we are reconciled with our Creator, our Heavenly Father. Here on this earth, we have access to Him, the throne room of grace where we can come before Him, crying out for every need. But one day in heaven, face to face forevermore with our Father God. That's the choice that Jesus is calling us to. Can I invite us to just close our eyes as we just respond to the word as has been read out today from Hebrews? I have two invitations today. The first invitation is, I believe someone here has been sitting on the fence when it comes to deciding to choose Jesus. You have heard the good news of Jesus. Your friends have told it to you. You have heard it from the altar. You have read about it on the internet. You know it, but you just haven't said, okay, Jesus, I believe you. Today, what you have heard is, when you believe Him, access to that superior sanctuary is yours. There is no downside. He paid the price so that you can live forevermore in the best place to be. And so my first invitation today is it time? Is today the day for you to respond to the call of our loving Heavenly Father and our Lord Jesus Christ? Is today the day where you receive His salvation and that you say, Jesus, I believe and I want the reward that is you. I want to be part of your story. I want to be part of your kingdom. So with all eyes closed, I'm just going to ask for a very simple response. On a count of three, if that is you, if today you decide, I don't want to sit on the fence anymore, I want to make a decision, and that decision is, I will believe that Jesus is real. On a count of three, wherever you are, just raise your hands, put it up there for 2 seconds, and put it down again. We do this for you to tell Jesus, to tell God, God, it's me. I'm responding, and I don't want to stay away from you anymore. I believe that you are Lord and King. So if that's you today, if you enough waiting on Jesus, enough thinking about it, enough sitting on a fence, why not let today be the day that you say, Jesus, I choose you. If that's you, on the count of three, 1, 2, 3, will you raise your hand? Thank you, I see your hand. It's amazing. Just give a moment more if anyone wants to respond to that invitation. Let today be the day that you say, Jesus, I believe that you died and rose again to save me from my sins. If that's you right now, just wherever you are, you're still free, just raise your hand for a moment, for a couple of seconds, and put it down again. Thank you. A second response. There is an earthly sanctuary, a carnal, a human way of doing things. And there is a heavenly, a godly, an amazing way of doing things. But I feel that maybe some of us here, we have gone through a season where we're stuck in a rut and we have lost sight of the heavenly things. It's like your feet are stuck in clay, your feet are stuck in mud, and you feel stuck and you can't rise up. What we're hearing today is Jesus comes to give us access into the heavenlies, access face to face with our Father God who hears and who answers prayers, access to a spirit of comfort and hope. So that second invitation, if that's any of you today, and you just don't want to stay in that place anymore, and you want to drink of the rivers of living water that Jesus promises, and you just don't want to stay in that rut, and you want to be lifted up, lifted in the Spirit by our Lord Jesus Christ, by the Holy Spirit. If that's you, wherever you are right now, can you just raise your hand to tell God, God, I don't want to be like this anymore. God, lift me up. God, I want your comfort. I want your help. I want your hope. If that's you, just wherever you are right now, if you can just raise your hand briefly and put it down, that's telling God, I don't want to be stuck in an earthly way of thinking, in an earthly state of mind. Lift me up, God. Lift me up, God. Yes, I see your hands. Yes, I see your hands. Can I invite us to rise to our feet now? If in your heart of hearts, today's message resonates with you, and you think maybe you're one of those people who somehow you're stuck staying in earthly sanctuaries, you have an earthly sanctuary state of mind, and you want to be lifted up by our Lord Jesus Christ, you want to have new hope in you, can I invite you today, come to the altar and just respond to Him. Come to the altar, and as you do that, you're telling rivers of living water to flow from within. I don't want to limit myself to an old way, to an imperfect way. I want to embrace a perfect way that was given to you by you, our perfect sacrifice. So if that's you today, can I just invite you, wherever you are and you want that lifting up, you want to look up and realize there is more to life than the things of this earth, you can come to the front and just make your altar with God at the left. If you want someone to pray with you, if you lifted your hand earlier and you said, I want to know more about Jesus, can I invite you, come to your front, come to your right, and someone will pray for you there. So on your left, if you just want to have some time and a transaction with God, and to your right, if you want someone to pray for you. Can I invite you, church, wherever you are, just come to the altar. That is the invitation of Hebrews chapter 9. That's the invitation of John chapter 7. That's the invitation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Don't stay away. Don't stay detached. Don't. He gives and He gives and He gives. And what we do is stretch out our hands and receive the gift of salvation, life that is truly life. So as we sing this song, church, can I invite you? Come to the altar. Just come to the altar and rediscover Jesus Christ. Access to a supreme sanctuary, a superior sanctuary. Come to the altar to appreciate Jesus Christ, the superior sacrifice.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new light is born. Jesus is calling. And oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. And forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. We bow down before Him. For He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't He wonderful? Sing hallelujah. The Christ is risen. Oh yes, He is. And bow down before Him. For He is Lord of all. Sing hallelujah. Christ is risen. Oh, come. And oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was born with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Forgiveness
was bought with the precious blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. A superior sacrifice. Forgiveness tearing open the veil, giving us access to the throne room of grace and mercy, the throne room of our Heavenly Father, the throne room where our Lord Jesus Christ sits at the right hand of Father God. It is a heavenly sanctuary. This is what He bought us when He paid the price with His blood. Relationship with Father God. Reconciliation with our Creator. Being made right with no obstacles standing between us and God. A lifting of the shame, a lifting of the guilt, a lifting of the burden. Thank you, our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you that you have given us so much. Thank you that you gave your life on the cross to pay the price for our sin. Teach us now to live a life in which we serve the living God. Always grateful, always thankful for what you have done for us on the cross. We receive this gift with thanksgiving and praise in Jesus' name. Go read out a few words of knowledge. And if these words mean anything to you, intercessors have been praying about them. If these words mean anything to you,
As we close the service, you can just come to the front and someone here will pray for you. For those of you who are online, you can log into our Breakthrough House Zoom and someone there will pray for you. There's a picture of a sword. Someone is distressed by the bickering, by the discord happening around you. There's a picture of a brick. Someone is feeling devastated and broken. God wants to rebuild, restore, renew you spiritually. Come for prayer. There's a picture of broken windows, trash thrown about in a house. Someone is in anguish because of your broken family. Come for prayer. So if these words mean anything to you, come to the altar. Or if any other prayer request, can come to the altar for prayer or go to a Breakthrough House Zoom room. Church, go with the love of the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and in fellowship of our Holy Spirit. Thank you, church.